turned it on.
You got it on?
No. I'm trying to figure out what's going on. I know I turned it all on.
Yeah.
Oh,
you gotta put the cable.
Oh. I thought you put it in.
No.
I don't know which one to put in.
I thought I had put it in my head.
You have to have the power on. Just put it on record.
Yeah,
I'm cuter with it. You need some buttons to push.
So let's go push over here.
Go push the TV.
Oh, come over here. Come on, let's go. Where's your dog?
Hey, Leah. Look who I have.
I have dolls. Oh, yeah. Wee! Twirls!
She wants to get the, she wants to run video recorder.
Yeah, maybe I don't.
She needs an apple. She wants an apple 2E. That would be a problem. Start small. Apple 2E.
Do you know anybody's got an IBM PC?
No, I know. There's a lot of companies that have.
My daughter's going to be in a dance show. The lady that's putting it on has one, but you can't get it to run a program, so she's looking for another one.
Can't get it to run programs?
To run the particular program that she needs for the show. It's like some kind of mail.
Yes. What was that, an old fashioned or Manhattan?
Yeah.
There's something not on. Down below there. That light.
What light?
Oh.
That light. Up above Paul.
I want to be able to Paul a little bit.
Light.
There's
the camera.
Action. Right. Oh, there you are. I know. If I say it's, feline neurosis.
Well. I was just a little anxious, so I put a couple of questions on the board that obviously either don't make any sense or do. Is there any third possibility? Okay.
Could possible?
Yes.
It's both? You mean both?
Look, would you agree? There's a description of midwifery. Agree? And there's also appended to that the distinctions that make philosophical. Midwifery. Agree?
Mm-hmm.
Well, given the dialogue of Theaetetus,
what part
would you say that it's exhibiting? On what principle can we say that these two parts relate to the strategy of the dialogue? Hey, Gina, look here. Should we ask, should we or should we not start with Steve, or do you want to hog it all and answer it all?
Typical choice.
Well.
Okay,
go ahead. Huh? Okay with you?
Yeah.
All right, go ahead and answer it.
I bet if he answers.
Oh, okay, fair enough.
Sure, who studied it more? I hear that Gina studied it for several years.
Tang has studied it more recently.
Well, then that's another principle.
The youngest should answer.
I only answer
questions. I go far more
right.
Yeah. I only answer
more
questions on the diversion.
Mm-hmm.
Then let's ignore it.
No.
Right, let's ignore it.
Fine.
I think it's important to ignore. We don't practice the art of ignoring questions. That's the trouble. Yeah, no, we
try.
Maybe we should go over what the text says about philosophical and ignoring.
Yeah, well. Probably just read from 160 to 165, and I'll show you how absurd it all is.
That's fair.
All right, so therefore we need a Theodorus and a Socrates.
I'll read one.
Thank you. Barbara?
Theaetetus, don't we?
Well, you can play Theaetetus. Good. Now we need a Socrates. Good. There you got the rules. At 160, here at last, after our somewhat painful labor.
Well, we have at last managed to bring this forth, whatever it turns out to be. And now that it is born, we must in very truth form the wider coming round with it in a circle, the circle of our argument.
Steve, you're going to have to either overcome all that traffic, close the door, or speak up.
Really?
Or both. Yeah, that's good because some people are at the further end of the room.
And see whether it may not turn out to be, after all, not worth rearing, but only a wind egg, an imposture. But perhaps you think that any offspring of yours ought to be cared for and not put away. Or will you bear to see it examined and not get angry if it is taken away from you, though it is your firstborn?
Theaetetus will be. Who's Theodorus? Is there one? You are. Aren't Theodorus? Theaetetus will bear it, Socrates, for he is not at all ill-tempered. But for heaven's sake, Socrates, tell me, is all this wrong, after all?
You are truly fond of argument, Theodorus, and a very good fellow. And can you, but you think that I am a sort of bag full of arguments and can easily pull one out and say that after all the other one was wrong. But you do not understand what is going on. None of the arguments come from me, but always from him who is talking with me. I myself know nothing, except just a little, enough to extract an argument from another man who is wise and to receive it fairly. And now I will try to extract this thought from Theaetetus, but not to say anything myself.
Would you do that again?
Mm-hmm.
From the top. I'm slow of thought, and therefore I don't read fast.
You mean what I just read?
Yes.
Where are the
okay. You are truly fond of argument, Theodorus, and a very good fellow. To think that I am a sort of bag full of arguments that can easily pull one out and say that, after all, the other one was wrong. But you do not understand what is going on. None of the arguments come from me.
Notice how polite the dude is.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Notice you
none of the
choice subtlety.
Yeah, none of the arguments comes from me, but always from him who was talking with me. I myself know nothing except just a little, enough to extract an argument from another man who is wise, and to receive it fairly. And now I will try to extract the spot from Theaetetus, but not to say anything myself.
That is the better way, Socrates. Do as you say.
But that's a interesting question. Part of your
question.
Hold back. Do you know then, Theodorus, what amazes me and your friend Pythagoras?
What is it?
In general, I like the doctrine of what appears to each one is to him. But I'm amazed by the beginning of his book. I don't see why he does not say in the beginning of his truth that a pig or a dog-faced baboon or some still stranger creature willing to have sensations is a measure of all things. Then he might have begun to speak to us very imposingly and condescendingly, showing that while we were honoring him, like a god for his wisdom, he was after all no better in intellect than any other man, or for that matter than a tadpole. What alternative is there, Theodorus? For if that opinion is true to each person which he acquires his sensation, and no one man can discern another's condition better than he himself, and one man has no better right to investigate whether another's opinion is true or false than he himself, but as we have said several times, each man is to form his own opinions by himself, and these opinions are always right and true. Why in the world, my friend, was Pythagoras wise, so that he could rightly be thought worthy to be the teacher of other men and to be well paid? And why were we ignorant creatures and obliged to go to school to him if each person is the measure of his own wisdom? Must we not believe that Pythagoras was playing to the gallery and saying all this? I say nothing of the ridicule that I and my science of midwifery deserve in that case, and I should say the whole practice of dialectics too. For would not the investigation of one another's fancies and opinions, and the attempt to refute them, when each man must be right, be tedious and blatant folly? If the truth of Pythagoras is true, and he was not jesting when he uttered his oracles from the shrine of his book.
Socrates, the man was my friend, as you just remarked, so I should hate to bring about the refutation of Pythagoras by agreeing with you. And I should hate also to oppose you contrary to my real convictions. So take Theaetetus again, especially as he seemed just now to follow your suggestions very carefully.
If you went to Sparta, Theodorus, and visited the wrestling schools, would you think it fair to look on at other people naked, some of whom were of poor physique, without stripping and showing your own form too?
Why not, if I could persuade them to allow me to do so? So now I think I shall persuade you to let me be a spectator, and not to drag me into the ring, since I am old and stiff, but to take the younger and nimbler man as your antagonist.
Well, Theodorus, if that pleases you, it does not displease me, as the saying is. So I must attack the wise Theaetetus again. Tell me, Theaetetus, referring to the doctrine we have just expounded, do you not share my amazement at being suddenly exalted to an equality with the wisest man, or even God? Or do you think Pythagoras' measure applies any less to gods than to men?
By no means, I'm amazed that you ask such a question at all. For when we were discussing the meaning of the doctrine, that whatever appears to each one really is to him, I thought it was good, but now it has suddenly changed to the opposite.
You're young, my dear boy, so you are quickly moved and swayed by popular oratory. Or in reply to what I have said in Pythagoras, or someone speaking before him, will say, excellent boys and old men, there you sit together declaiming to the people what you bring and the gods. Question of which existence or non-existence I exclude from moral and written discussion. Do you say the sort of thing that the crowd would easily accept that it is a terrible thing if every man is no better than any beast in point of wisdom? But you do not advance any cogent proof whatsoever. You base your thoughts on probability. If Theodorus or any other geometrician should base his geometry on probability, he would be of no account at all. So you and Theodorus had better consider whether you will accept arguments founded on plausibility and probabilities in such important matters.
That would not be right, Socrates. Neither you nor we should think so.
Apparently, then, you and Theodorus mean we must look at the matter in a different way.
Yes, certainly in a different way.
Well, then, let's look at it in this way, raising the question of
Okay, what went on in this section? What happened in this section?
Propounded an absurdity in the document of management.
Well, look here. Let's get Theotetus' statement again. Would you read Theotetus' statement?
Which statement?
At 162D.
By no means. I am amazed that you ask such a question at all. Since when we were discussing the meaning of the doctrine, that whatever appears to each one really is to him, I thought it was good. But now it has suddenly changed to the opposite.
Oh, yeah.
What happened, Bill?
Bye.
What happened?
Miscarriage?
He certainly got his opinion switched.
How fast?
Instantly.
Suddenly. Here is that.
Does he accept that style of reasoning?
Possible.
Does Socrates accept it? Look at, would you agree, he just got a man to agree that the whole position that he has been developing is absurd. Would you agree with that?
Mm-hmm. He certainly did.
All right. Then he turns around and points out that that's not the proper style. That there's something inherently wrong with that kind of reasoning. Is that right? You mean in the middle of this discussion or exploration, we're having a rather curious phenomenon take place, aren't we? That Socrates is using rhetorical arguments to refute a position, is he not? Yes or not?
Yes.
Come on. Is Socrates,
he did it in the beginning,
using rhetorical arguments to win a point, right? To overcome the position. And then points out the falsity. Does he not? Then points out the falsity, criticizing his own approach and his colleagues' acceptance. Disappointed in life, right? Yeah, this is one of the early dialogues. It was very badly executed, poorly designed, and it has these flaws in it. I mean, it won't happen again, except a couple more times. Is that right, Paul? I mean, can you imagine a dialogue presumably about midlife when it ends up being nothing more than rhetorical traps, sophistical devices to win an agreement? Come. What is
that? I would think that would be strange.
Well, is it strange though?
Yes.
It's going to get worse. Okay, let's go. Okay, we continue. 163A. Socrates?
Oh, yes. 163. Yeah. Apparently, then, you and Theodorus mean we must look at the matter in a different way.
Yes, certainly in a different way.
Well then, let us look at it in this way, raising the question whether knowledge is, after all, the same as perception or different. That is the object of all our discussion, and it was to answer that question. It stirred up all these strange doctrines, was it not?
Most assuredly.
Should we then agree that all that we perceive by sight or hearing we know?
Keep going.
Yeah. For instance, shall we say that before having learned the language of foreigners, we do not hear them when they speak? Whether we both hear and know what they say. And again, if we do not know the letters, shall we maintain that we do not see them when we look at them, or that if we really see them, we know them?
We shall say, Socrates, that we know just so much of them as we hear or see. In the case of the letters, we both see and know the form and color, and in the spoken language, we both hear and at the same time know the higher and lower notes of the voice. But we do not perceive through sight or hearing, and we do not know what the grammarians or the interpreters teach about them.
First, what does that mean?
We can distinguish sounds, but we can't tell what those sounds mean. Or in the case of letters, we can distinguish shapes and form, but not.
So that then we are perceiving, but we are not
understanding.
Knowing. Not knowing.
Yes.
Right. Okay, keep going.
First rate, Theodetus. And it is a pity to dispute that, for I want you to grow. But look out for another trouble that is yonder coming towards us and see how we can repel it.
What is it?
It's like this. Anyone should ask, is it possible that a man has ever known a thing, still has, and preserves memory of that thing, that he does not at the same time when he remembers, know that very thing which he remembers? I seem to be pretty long-winded, but I really want to ask if a man who has learned a thing does not know it when he remembers it.
Of course he does, Socrates, for what you suggest would be monstrous.
Am I crazy then? Look here. Do you not see that seeing is perceiving, do you not say that seeing is perceiving and that sight is perception?
I do.
Then according to what we have just said, the man who has seen a thing has acquired knowledge of that which he has seen.
Yes.
Well then, do you not admit that there is such a thing as memory?
Yes.
Memory of nothing or of something?
Of something, surely.
Of things he has learned and perceived, that sort of thing?
Of course.
A man sometimes remembers what he has seen, does he not?
He does.
Even when he shuts his eyes, or does he forget if he does that?
It would be absurd to say that, Socrates.
We must, though. If we are to maintain our previous argument, otherwise it is all up.
I too, by Zeus, have my suspicions, but I don't fully understand you. Tell me how it is.
This is how it is. He who sees has acquired knowledge, we say, of that which he has seen. For it is agreed that sight and perception and knowledge are all the same.
Certainly.
But he who has seen and has acquired knowledge of what we say, if he shuts his eyes, remembers, but does not see it. Is that right?
Yes.
But does not see is the same as does not know. If it is true that seeing is knowing?
True.
Then this is our result. When a man has acquired knowledge of a thing and still remembers it, he does not know it, since he does not see it. But we said that would be a monstrous conclusion.
But very true.
So evidently we reach an impossible result if we say that knowledge and perception are the same.
So it seems.
Then we must say they are different.
I suppose so.
Then what can knowledge be? We must apparently begin our discussion all over again. And yet, Theodetus, what are we on the point of doing?
About what?
It seems to me that we are behaving like a worthless gamecock. Before winning the victory, we have left away from our argument and begun to grow.
How so?
We seem to be acting like professional debaters. We have based our agreements on the mere similarity of words. And are satisfied we have confidently argued in that way. And we do not see that we who claim to be not contestants for a prize, but lovers of wisdom, are doing just what those ingenious persons do.
Okay, that's enough. What's going on? Between 163A and 164D. Another, Paul? Where? What do you mean you got home? Read it. Come on, go back.
Okay.
Go back to 164B. Read it. Socrates, go ahead. Write it, please. Go ahead. Gina Platitudes. Come on, Socrates.
Who has seen and has acquired knowledge of what he saw, if he shut his eyes, remembers it, but does not see it.
Where are you?
That's right. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Page 85.
Oh, okay.
But are you there?
Okay, but does not see it. True. Where are you?
Go. I was at the sentence that you just
hit by. Okay.
Gotcha. Yes.
But does not see is the same as does not know.
Is that right, Paul?
If it is true that seeing is knowledge.
If knowledge is perception, would that be the same? If you see it, you know it?
If it does not see.
Seeing is perception, is it not?
No.
Isn't perceiving, seeing and perceiving the same?
Okay, in a sense.
Sense of sight.
That's all I need.
Okay.
Is it?
But he's not seeing, he's not knowing.
Then if he's not seeing, he ain't knowing, is it? Paul, is that right?
I don't have that last connection, that last con.
What did you say? Did you say does not see means does not know? Is to see to know, according to this theory?
According to this theory?
Yeah. If knowledge is perception, does that mean to see is to know?
Okay, according to that theory, yes.
Yeah, okay. Is the converse does not see, does not know?
Oh, yes.
All right. Hey, what's this? What is it? What do you recall?
I recall chalk.
But that's not knowledge, is it?
That's not knowledge.
According to this theory, what's knowledge? Only when you do what?
See it.
Right, can't use your memory because that doesn't cover it, does it?
Okay.
Okay, go back, read it again. 164B, write it B.
164B. But he who has seen and has acquired knowledge of what he saw, if he shuts his eyes, remembers it, but does not see it, is that right? But does not see is the same as does not know, if it is true that seeing is knowledge.
Is that correct? Paul?
But does not see is the same as does not know, if it is true that seeing is knowing, yes.
Yeah, conclude, keep going.
Then this is our result. When a man has acquired knowledge of a thing and still remembers it, he does not know it, since he does not see it. But we said that would be a monstrous conclusion.
Right, I agree, just as you were saying. But yet it follows from the theory, doesn't it?
Right.
Well, he'd have to agree with it, though, in terms of the theory, wouldn't he?
Right.
What does he do with them? All right. Keep reading.
So evidently, we reach an impossible result, if we say that knowledge and perception are the same.
Right? Is that correct?
Impossible.
Keep going.
So then we must say that they are different.
Jane?
So it seems.
Keep going.
Then what can knowledge be? We must apparently begin our discussion all over again. And yet, Theaetetus, what are we on the point of doing?
About what?
It seems to me we have been behaving like a worthless game cock. Before winning the victory, we have leapt away from our argument and begun to crow.
How so?
We seem to be acting like professional debaters. We have based our agreements on the mere similarity of words and are satisfied to have got the better of the agreement in such a way, and we do not see that we who claim to be not contestants for a prize but lovers of wisdom.
Yeah. So look here, is this another case of the same thing? Is he saying what we just did was argue like professional debaters? And he's criticizing himself? But didn't he bring Theaetetus again to a conclusion?
Yeah.
So that he saw that it was absurd?
Sounded pretty good to me.
He's saying, hey, that's not the way to go.
I do that stuff all the time.
Agree? Look here. This is arguing only on verbal consistency, or what we would call logic.
Huh, no wonder I didn't recognize
it. So that's not it. That's what professional debaters do. That's not dialogue. That's not dialectic. Look here, would you agree? We've reached another point where the same thing can be said. But is Socrates using rhetorical arguments to overcome the position? And then does he point out the falsity, criticizing his own approach and his colleagues?
Yeah, but is it a falsity in the argument or is it in the approach?
Falsity.
I mean, would you say that that argument is inaccurate?
Yes.
It is inaccurate?
Yeah.
It's not true?
No.
Is that right?
Yes.
I don't see that.
He gives him this one too, doesn't he? He says, hey, look here, if to see is to know, then if you write something in a language people are not familiar with, then if they see it, they should know it. He's saying, you know what that is? That's gaining an agreement on pure verbal consistency. That's the way professional debaters go.
I'll go along with that one. How about the memory one, though?
same thing. Because someone could have responded, excuse me, Socrates, do you not perceive it when you recall it in your memory?
Oh, okay.
All right. In other words, look here. You see, the first level in any debate, let me retract that. The first level in an exploration of a problem is to do away with that, to see through it and not to be satisfied with it. He calls this heuristic reasoning at times. This is the term they often use. Heuristic reasoning. To reason to win, to be guided only by logic. Because that's inadequate. Don't do that. Okay, he's not going to do it again. Will he? Can? He won't do it again, will he? He won't do this again, will he?
I just hope so.
You think he'll do that again? He's a cheat. He's a sneak, isn't he? All right, once more. Let's go on. Is the point being made, yes or no?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Right? Yes. Mm-hmm. Because then we have this question. What's he doing? How does this using rhetorical arguments fit?
Jesus, yeah.
Yeah, okay, let's go on, since it's obvious.
I don't know. I wasn't too clear on the first part even before we got to this part. You know, about the before 160, he was using rhetoric. You know? And then he says, just mere plausibility. So I have to go back and see those. That was the demonstration of sight, wasn't it? The passive and the aggressive. There, go ahead. Since heuristic logic is very...
very dear to our
name.
Very dear to my soul.
That's right.
I don't want to reject it out of sight.
It sounds like it's very truthful.
Yeah. Yeah, here. Get your truck.
Hi there.
Hey, Rabbit.
Are you going to dance?
Hey, Rabbit. Oh, you want to dance? No, okay. Do your own dance, you grizzly-faced old man. Okay. Yeah, it's okay. You can be a teacher.
So as much as we like the Chinese laundry argument, that it's not enough to do the trick.
Well, he's setting up positions.
He's setting up positions?
Well, last week you were talking about the fact that he's... What would be enough to bring to birth in the dialogue? I mean...
Duck!
What would be enough material that you would have to get in order to be satisfied that the position has been given birth to? And we were talking about the different positions, Pythagoras or Aquinas. It looks like he's also including in that the kinds of arguments that can be used against those positions.
What does he think?
He doesn't think that they are...
You see, this is why this dialogue has been contested by many authorities. To be really unplatonic, it was probably written by probably some cook lived in the academy. Because obviously there's no place for these kinds of rhetorical devices in a serious work like this. Right, Paul?
Yeah, that sounds plausible. That sounds very plausible.
Possibly for
well, in that he's doing it. But
yeah, in that he's
to,
doing it. Yeah.
He's doing it.
Yeah,
how
true.
That relates to the art of midwifery, I don't see that. But in
well,
that he's
I,
doing
it. Oh, then you can't answer the question.
No.
But you're asking me.
Well, I thought you'd know.
Did you see her shower?
Or maybe I just enjoyed
having
you.
Did you see her shower me with all kinds of money?
Beer, six packs.
Nothing.
I made popcorn.
Right? And she wants me to work.
I think I was just appreciating the question.
I mean, is the question, is there a place for rhetoric in midwifery? Is that the question?
Well. No. Close though.
Or is there another?
Close. Okay, shall we charge your head?
Sure.
We'll get no more of this anymore, right, Paul?
No more of this.
No more of this sophistical, rhetorical argumentation. Get real serious and handle this.
Right.
Good.
Would this be, could this possibly be a way of looking at midwifery versus psychology?
Yes, mostly psychology deals only with rhetoric, but I agree with that.
Oh.
And those trained in psychology are trained in rhetoric.
Right.
Well, maybe rhetoric's the only thing people will pay for.
They'll pay for that. I'll tell you.
They'll pay for anything.
Oh, yeah. What am I going to do? I'm going to get a kiss.
That's what that is, huh? Is that a kiss?
No, she wants to eat some chocolate. She wants to eat some chocolate.
She hadn't found library paste yet.
Hey, Dolly.
Library paste is great.
She's got a nice dolly, doesn't she? She's pregnant.
I'm sure she'll find that out.
Is that being pregnant?
Yeah.
Sure?
Why don't you tell us?
Come here. Aaliyah.
You're being called.
Aaliyah. Wait, how's your belly gone? Yeah, see, that's it.
That's right, belly. God.
Okay. I'm teaching her anatomy. Yeah.
Where's your mouth?
Okay, we charge. 163A.
Well, I'm trying to make my thoughts clear. 163A?
No, no, no. Where did we go? We went to the top of 163D, didn't we?
What's
yes. Yeah. Okay, go ahead. Or,
well, I will try to make my thought clear. We ask, you recollect, whether a man who has learned something in, or did we get back?
No, no. 164C, isn't that
yeah,
right?
Let's go. Yeah. Then what can knowledge be?
All right. Then what can knowledge be? We must apparently begin our discussion over again.
And sure, you certainly need to. Agree? I mean, all this rhetoric and that, so.
And yet, the Adidas, what are we on the point of doing?
About what?
You wouldn't get proof.
It seems to me that we are behaving like a worthless game car. Before winning the victory, we have left away from our argument and begun to grow.
How so?
We seem to be acting like professional debaters. We have based our agreements on the mere similarity of words and are satisfied to have got better of the argument in that way. And we don't see that we who claim to be not contestants for a prize, but lovers of wisdom, are doing just what those ingenious persons do.
I do not yet understand what you mean.
Well, I will try to make my thought clear. We ask you recollect whether a man who has learned something and remembers it does not know it. We show first that the one who has seen and then shuts his eyes remembers, although he does not see. And then we show that he does not know, although at the same time he remembers. But this, we said, was impossible, and so the Protagorean tale was brought to naught. And yours also about the identity of knowledge and
perception.
It would not be so, I bet you, my friend, if the father of the person was jailed for a lie. He would have had a good deal to say in his defense. But he is dead, and we are abusing the orphan. Why, even the guardians whom Protagoras left, one of whom is Theodorus here, are unwilling to come to the child's assistance. So it seems that we shall have to do it ourselves, assisting him in the name of justice.
Do so, for it is not I, Socrates, but rather Callias, the son of Hipponicus, who is the guardian of his children. As for me, I turned rather too soon from abstract speculations to geometry. However, I shall be grateful to you if you come to his assistance.
Good, Theodorus. Now, let's see how I shall help him. For a man might find himself involved in still worse inconsistencies than those in which we find ourselves just now, if he did not pay attention to the terms which we generally use in sending them out. Shall I explain this to you, or call it to Theodorus?
To both of us. But let the younger answer, for he will be less disgraced if he is discomfited.
Very well. Now I'm going to ask the most frightfully difficult question of all. It runs, I believe, something like this. Is it possible for a person, if he knows a thing at the same time, not to know about what he knows?
Now then, what shall we answer, Theophile?
It is impossible, I should think.
Not if you make seeing and knowing identical. For what will you do with a question from which there is no escape, by which you are, as the saying is, caught in a fit, when your adversary, unabashed, puts his hand over one of your eyes and asks if you see his cloak with the eye that is covered.
I thought this was weak. This was chicken. This was an argument I thought that was really
This is
weak.
The most frightfully difficult argument?
I shall say, I think, not with that eye, but with the other.
Then you see and do not see the same thing at the same time?
After a fashion.
That, he will reply, is not at all what I want, and I do not ask about the fashion, or whether you both know and do not know the same thing. Now, manifestly, you see that which you do not see, but you have agreed that seeing is knowing, and not seeing is not knowing. Very well. From all this, reckon out what the result is.
Well, I reckon out that the result is the contrary of my hypothesis.
And perhaps, my fine fellow, more troubles of the same sort might have come upon you if anyone asks you further questions. Whether it is possible to know the same thing both sharply and dully, to know close at hand but not at a distance, to know both violently and gently, and countless other questions such as a nimble fighter, fighting for pay and a war of words might have lain in wait and asked you when you said that knowledge and perception were the same thing. He would have charged down upon hearing and smelling in such senses and would have argued persistently and unceasingly until you were filled with admiration of his greatly desired wisdom and were taken in his toils.
Okay.
That's the way it's done.
Huh?
That's the way it's done.
That's showing the consequences of the position are absurd. That's another way of rejecting it. What?
It's logical.
Yeah, but does he accept this third one, or does he reject that as well?
Well, he rejects it. Socrates rejects
it. Wait a minute. Did it not win again? Didn't Theaetetus again for the third time give up?
Third or fourth or fifth?
Third.
Mm-hmm. Third poem. The rest of them. It's the third poem.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, I reckon out that the result is the contrary of my hypothesis.
Does he again reject it?
Yes.
What's going on?
We don't know. But we can guess.
Theaetetus is very young.
Socrates is clowning. What's that got to do with midwife?
Yeah.
It's testing him.
Right, wait a minute. Right, Paul? He's what?
He's testing him.
What do you mean he's testing him?
Well, he wants to see what he will accept as a refutation of an argument.
As the great Chinese sage said, so
what?
Oh, he's testing me.
Well,
what's that got? Yeah, go ahead. I mean, can you push it? Or?
And after he tests him and he accepts the argument that Socrates gives, Socrates goes back and corrects it as if to say, don't.
Yeah, we agree.
Don't.
So, yeah,
okay.
Therefore, how does that fit in then? Yeah, we agree with you.
With midwifery?
Yeah.
Well.
Yeah, that's what he's doing. Yeah. What's that got to do with midwifery?
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Amniocentesis.
What? Come on, Jim.
She was mentioning tests, and I was thinking, in terms of midwifery, there are certain tests in terms of how to judge whether the person's pregnant or not. And also to...
Yeah, that's true, but he's already been to...
He's already said that.
Okay.
They concluded that.
Yeah, okay, so he's testing. Yeah, we know he's testing, so now how can we use that? Besides asking Barbara.
Did you
Well, that's a principle.
What does this stuff have to do with the library? It's all rhetorical, isn't it?
Yeah, but that's what goes on. That is the...
Isn't he saying that these are unfair tests, though? Rhetorical as opposed to...
I would hazard a
career. Real testing?
No, but isn't this what we accept? Isn't this what we accept in a problem? We accept rhetoric. And it, and
well,
he...
Wait, I'll offer a clue. I've got a clue. I know I've got a clue. That this is all after the birth. This is all within the art of midwife, but this has to be practiced after the actual birth of the infant conception.
Yeah, okay. So that's true. So
what's a clue?
What part?
That's a clue.
All right, okay. I don't want to knock it. Okay, let's keep on reading. Maybe we'll bump into something.
I wanted to offer that insofar as these are described as ploys that should not be accepted as adequate argumentation, that they are in a sense like lines that a potential lover for Theaetetus might have used to engender a child in Theaetetus' soul, and that by going through these he is wiping out the possibility of there being this kind of argument born of Theaetetus' soul.
You mean in the future?
Yeah, probably right. Want to keep reading?
Yeah. 165. This is a good gift.
Yeah.
You have charged down upon hearing and smelling in such senses and would have argued persistently and unceasingly until you were filled with admiration and this greatly desired wisdom and taking this poison. And then, after subduing and binding you, he would at once proceed to bargain with you for such ransom as might be agreed upon between you.
All right, continue.
What argument then, you might ask, will Protagoras produce to strengthen his forces? Shall we try to carry on the discussion?
By all means.
Wait a minute, what's going on?
It's language of a battle, striking his forces.
Language of charge down. Charge down.
Yeah. Alright, keep going. Let's go.
Well, the purpose of these arguments is not for the benefit of the person, but of the person who's giving the arguments.
That's glad to hear that. You know, Jesus comes back with the immortal words.
By all means.
Yep.
They're you know, they're wanting to win. Obviously in a battle. But the true purpose is to obtain truth, I would say.
Well, why isn't that true?
But isn't
what?
Isn't part of the...
I always say yes when someone says that. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, it seems like in midwifery we want to see what it is that the person whom we end up believing is doing. That is, how is he functioning and in what way did we end up believing him?
Oh, I see what you're asking now. In the actual... Oh, I see what you do.
Boy, you see a lot more.
Well, good.
Maybe you can explain
it out.
No.
Gina just jumped into a different kind of midwifery to try to explain this dilemma. Just in case you're not there. Yeah. Right, Jane?
Rhetorical midwife.
Yes, you were saying, you see this? What's the point?
Well, I mean, I just realized that to your question, and the level you think of it is the midwifery as we do a midwifery program, actually. What exactly
would
that kind of
thing? No. This has to do with right here in this little
old
book. This old $2.75 book of mine.
Well, I thought that was a force of
genius. Yeah, I did too. Okay, but shall we go back?
Sure.
Well,
right.
I guess I will.
What? I mean, would you say we can understand this dialogue by reference to what's going on in 1985?
I wouldn't.
Or shall we try to do it in terms of what's going on here?
Well, I didn't see a difference, but I...
You don't see a difference?
Tell you the truth, no, I didn't at that
point. Good, then find me a quote where what you're saying can be found, can be said.
Well, I was just thinking about what he was saying with respect to such senses, that he would have charged down upon hearing and smelling in such senses and would argue persistently and unceasingly until you were filled with admiration of his greatly desired wisdom. And were taking in his toils, and then after subduing you and binding you, he would at once proceed to bargain with you for such ransom as might be agreed upon between you.
Yeah, so?
Well, just...
Don't use the word saying.
Okay. At the time, it occurred to me that...
My best insight into the matter. Go ahead.
Well, I was seeing that parents often use these devices to convince their children. Mm-hmm. At least that's what I remember in my wife talks. I remember them in mine.
Yeah, okay.
So
good.
That's why I went there.
Yeah, okay. Shall we keep reading?
All right. He will, I fancy, say all that we have said in his defense, and then will close with the saying contemptuously. Our estimable Socrates, we were frightened a little boy by asking if it was possible for one and the same person to remember, and at the same time not to know one and the same thing. And when the child in his fright said no, because he could not foresee what would result, Socrates made poor me a laughingstock in his talk. But you, you slovenly Socrates, the facts stand thus. When you examine any doctrine of mine by the method of questioning, if the person who is questioned makes such what replies as I should make and comes to grief, then I am refuted. But if his replies are quite different, then the person questioned is refuted, not I. Take this example. Do you suppose you could get anybody to admit that the memory of a man has of a past feeling he no longer feels is anything like the feeling at the time when he was feeling it? Far from it. Or that he would refuse to admit that it is possible for one and the same person to know and not to know one and the same thing? Or if he were afraid to admit this, would he ever admit that a person who has become unlike is the same as before he became unlike? In fact, if we are to be on our guard against such verbal entanglements, would he admit that a person is one at all, and not many who become infinite in number? And if the process of becoming different continues? But, my dear fellow, he will say, attack my real doctrines in a more generous manner, and prove if you can that perceptions, when they come or become to each of us, are not individual. Or that if they are individual, what appears to each one would not, for all that, become to that one alone. Or if you prefer to say, be, would not be to whom it appears. But when you talk of pigs and dog-faced baboons, you not only act like a pig yourself, but you persuade your hearers to act so toward my writings. And that is not right. For I maintain that the truth is as I have written. Each one of us is the measure of the things that are and those that are not. But each person differs immeasurably from every other in just this, that to one person some things appear and are, and to another person other things. And I do not by any means say that wisdom and the wise man do not exist. On the contrary, I say that if bad things appear and are to any one of us, precisely that man is wise who causes a change and makes good things appear and be to him. And moreover, do not lay too much stress upon the words of my argument, but get a clear understanding of my meaning for what I am going to say. Recall to mind what was said before, that his food appears and is bitter to the sick man, but appears and is the opposite of bitter to the man in health. Now neither of these two is to be made wiser than he is. That is not possible. Nor should the claim be made that the sick man is ignorant because his opinions are ignorant, or the healthy man wise because his are different. But a change must be made from the one condition to the other, for the other is better. So too in education. A change has to be made from a worse to a better condition, but the physician causes the change by means of drugs, and the teacher of wisdom by means of words. And yet, in fact, no one ever made anyone think truly who previously thought falsely, since it is impossible to think that which is not.
Good. Stop.
Yeah.
Hey, what did you do with these three arguments? What did you do with those three arguments?
The person did not the argument.
Yeah.
He said, hey, you're arguing with a kid. Mm-hmm. The kid's afraid to deal with those consequences. Why not? Accept them. Say, well, that's the way it is, that's the way it is. May seem absurd to you. Hey, that's not the issue. The question is, if that's where the position goes, that's what you hold on to. Is that what he's saying? Let's go back. Come on. You find a little boy who's scared. Got that?
Yes. Our estimable Socrates here frightened a little boy by asking if it was possible for one and the same thing, for one and the same person to remember, and at the same time not to know one and the same thing. But when the child in his fright answered no, because he could not foresee what would result, Socrates made poor me a laughingstock in his talk. But you, slumming Socrates.
Right, that's right. Right. What's your name? Saying it, you. Reasoning in such a way as to make me the butt of your jokes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that presupposes that there's some kid there who isn't willing to take the consequences of the argument. So it looks very foolish and looks absurd. There's nothing absurd about it, but that's the way the argument goes. That's the way the argument goes. And if the gentleman in question is unable to push the question and accept those consequences, blame him. Don't blame my position. My position is still excellent. Mm-hmm. Is that what he's doing?
Of course. You don't touch my position. Yeah. They're refuting the person, not the
argument.
Well,
yeah. Right.
Argue.
Personality. you say, I am sitting, and I am standing, might as well I be one of the two, or I only am one of the sitting. And you want to niggle about those kind of things.
That, or are you one or many?
One of the rejecting the whole
what's
line of argument, style of action. With a rhetorical argument?
They're all rhetorical arguments, but they need not be. A person could have accepted them and said, yeah, well, that's where the position is, and that's the nature of it.
Are we going to play a little bit with Tigris' methods of reasoning?
Well, we have to make sure that we see what he's doing, or is this rhetoric? Come on. Is this empty, or is this real? Come on. Buy it.
Is it his first example? Do you suppose you can get anybody to admit that the memory a man has of a past feeling? He no longer feels of anything at the time when he's feeling?
If you have an experience or something, and later you recall it, there's obviously going to be a difference between the original experience and the image of it called a memory. There's always going to be a difference. To the degree that it's a difference between the two, then one is more lively and more real than the other, isn't it?
Okay, he's got
well, so then you really knew at one time, and now to some degree, since it's less, to that very degree, you don't know. So any remembered event is always a condition where you, in one way, know, and another way, you don't know.
That may not always be true.
Why not?
He may have a point, because he's limiting his argument to feeling.
No, that's not feeling. That's memory.
Is that your justice? Feeling?
I don't know. How's yours? I don't think
remembering of a feeling.
Suppose you could get anybody to admit that the memory a man has of a past feeling,
yeah, feeling is a sensation.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
Sensation.
Okay. But it's like when it was originally presented, someone learns something, knows something. And then you say that he doesn't know what he remembers. That's not limited to perception at that point, but it is by the prior argument.
Glad you should have turned around and accepted that. It saved me a lot of work. Keep doing that. Don't. That guy's good that way. Wow. Okay, now, come on, let's go to the next paragraph. Right?
Or that he was refused to admit that. You mean, way above her?
167A.
All right. Education?
Yeah.
So to an education, a change has to be made from a worse to a better condition. Are you going to go? What, you want to go right there?
Yeah, go ahead.
Or now,
keep going. Come on.
Or where we stopped off. What are you going to do?
You're on education. Continue.
We've got to go back a little way to that one. I think that's 166E.
167.
167, is it? Okay. So too in education. A change has to be made from a worse to a better condition. Anyway. But the position causes the change by means of drugs, and the teacher of wisdom by means of words. And yet, in fact, no one ever made anyone think truly from previously taught falsely. Since it is impossible to think that which is not, or to think any other things than those which one feels. And these are always true. But I believe that a man who, on account of a bad condition of soul, thinks thoughts akin to that, thoughts akin to that condition, is made by a good condition of soul to think correspondingly good thoughts. And some men, through inexperience, call these appearances true, whereas I call them better than the other, but in no wise truer. From the wise mind, dear Socrates, I did not by any means call tadpoles. When they had to do with the human body, I called them physicians, and when they had to do with plants, husbandmen. For I assert that these latter, when plants are sickly, instill into them good and healthy sensation. And true ones instead of bad sensation. That the wise and good orders make the good instead of the evil, seeing to be right for their states. For I claim that whatever seems right and honorable to a state is really right and honorable to it so long as it pleases it to be so. The wise man causes the good instead of that which is evil to them in each instance to be and see right and honorable. And on the same principle, the teacher who is able to train his pupils in this matter is not only wise, but is also entitled to receive high pay from them when their education is finished. And in this sense, it is true that some men are wiser than others, and that no one thinks falsely, and that you, whether you will or no, must endure to be a measure. Upon these positions, my doctrine stands firm, and if you can dispute it in principle, dispute it by bringing an opposing doctrine against it, or if you prefer the method of question, ask questions. For an intelligent man ought not to reject this method, on the contrary, he should choose it before all others. However, let me make a suggestion. Do not be unfair in your questioning. It is very inconsistent for a man who asserts that he cares for virtue to be constantly unfair in discussion. And it is unfair in discussion when a man makes no distinction between merely trying to...
Slower, huh?
And it is unfair in discussion when a man makes no distinction between merely trying to make points and carrying out a real argument. In the former, he may jest and try to trip up his opponent as much as he can. But in real argument, he must be in earnest. He must set his interlocutor on his feet, pointing out to him those steps only which are due to himself and his previous association. For if you act in this way, those who debate with you will cast the blame for the confusion and perplexity upon themselves, not upon you. They will run after you and love you. They will hate themselves and run away from themselves, taking refuge in philosophy, that they may escape from their former selves by becoming different. But if you act in the opposite way, as most teachers do, you will produce the opposite result. And instead of making your young associates philosophers, you will make them hate philosophy when they grow older. If, therefore, you accept the suggestion which I made before, you will avoid a hostile and combative attitude, and in a gracious spirit will enter the lists with me and inquire what we really mean when we declare that all things are in motion and that whatever seems is to each individual, whether man or state. And on the basis of that, you will consider the question whether knowledge and perception are the same or different, instead of doing as you did a while ago, using as your basis the ordinary meaning of names and words, which most people pervert in haphazard ways and thereby cause all sort of perplexity in one another. Such, Theodorus, is the help I have furnished, your friend, to the best of my ability. Not much, for my resources are small. But if he were living himself, he would have helped his offspring in a fashion more magnificent.
You're joking, Socrates.
Okay, good. That's all good.
I can't believe Pythagoras would have said that.
Yeah, I know.
No way.
Okay, what did he do? All right, come on, what did he do? What do you call that section?
Oh, that's the bringing of the crooked straight or something.
Raising of the
what was the effect it had? What was the effect of this last section had on you and your understanding of what went on?
It made me tired, sleepy, and think. Oh, I gotta go back and pull this apart. And wait a minute. This is
work.
Very familiar.
Barbara, what's this?
Well, some parts of it made me highly suspicious. Parts about wisdom, you know, and how it is that a wise man functions towards people, making them better. Able to have what is, to see what is, that what is right will seem to them, and that a man can function towards people in that way. That
what did Socrates do to this position in Pythagoras' section?
What did he do to it?
No. What effect did it have on
him? What effect did it have? Just as you were reading, as we were going through it, instead. What did it do?
Well, It's confusing.
We could break it into parts, couldn't we?
Yes. Yes.
We could break it into parts. But remember this question: is Socrates using rhetorical arguments to overcome the position and then point out the falsity, criticizing his own approach and that of his colleague? Now what is he doing? What's the essential to it?
He just needed time to put it on the line. It seemed like he gave it the best position you could possibly get, even better than Pythagoras himself.
Oh, this is a rhetorical argument that refutes it.
He rebuilds, does he not? Mm-hmm. He rebuilds the position.
Oh, yeah.
In a grand style.
Right.
Yeah. There's no way Pythagoras...
Overcomes the past objections, does he not?
Right. Just word games, for one.
Right. And he blames it on seeing, right, the immaturity of the person he's speaking to. Right. He said, actually, right, he rebuilds the position, overcomes the past objection, points out the agreements were due to Theaetetus is an experience, right?
Please, for your generosity, pardon, pardon, sorry.
And therefore, for each of these points, he shows what you can do with them. Okay. But you don't have to be afraid of those conclusions. Yeah. You can accept them. Those are the consequences of the position. That's the consequence of the position. So. Mm.
Yeah.
And then in doing it, does he rebuild the position stronger than before?
That's right. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, both sides. Yeah, that's
the... And then sets up the method for arguing.
Right. Stronger than previously? He rebuilds and makes it stronger than previously? Yes.
Now that we've brought up the burden, do we have to carry it around and bury the truth, certain of our argument?
Say, look here, suppose I were to ask another question, simpler by heavens than all the ones we've been playing with today. What would you say constitutes midwifery? I imagine you'd be able to go back to that earlier section and list them all, would you not? And then the differences in philosophical midwifery, would you not?
Oh, this is another art.
Will you not?
This is another art.
And then we could say, hey, does this fit in any of that?
This is beyond the art.
Come on, louder.
This is beyond the art.
This is the art of the art.
Beyond the art of midwifery, is what he's saying.
Oh, it's beyond. I didn't hear him.
There are.
Barbara, you encourage him when he gets
the book. I'll try to. I get a little impatient from stuff.
Yeah. Is that a name of a book? Or what?
Beyond the
beyond
art.
Beyond the art of midwifery.
Well,
why don't we get there?
In other words, you're saying, is this a necessary part? In other words, in the art itself, and in the chain of events that occur from conception to delivery.
We're gonna go back to the section I've been working on, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, yeah, I got to know.
What would you say it is then?
How is this a test? There's nothing.
Well, he's using several different approaches and coming up with negative
Okay, let's assume that we're correct in the point that this is a test, to prove by every test. What will that test provide for us?
Whether or not the guy will buy rhetoric, I guess.
Whether the offspring of the young man's thought is a false phantom or instinct of life and truth. Where does that fit in the life of
That does not fit in the life. That is where his art differs from the mind. That's where his individual, philosophical individual, differs from human midwife. That's what it says.
Yeah, his midwifery has to be different than midwifery itself.
Yeah.
Otherwise, he'd be going around administering to women who are pregnant.
Oh, would you speak up a little bit?
Sure. Yeah, well, he said, my art of midwifery is the same at every point except one. And that one point is to test
the do you have that word, by the way? In the show?
Sure.
Yeah, I want to read it.
Although it's true of their art of midwifery is true also of mine. But mine differs from theirs in being practicing men, not women, and intending their souls and their, not their bodies. But the greatest thing about my art is this, that it can test in every way with the mind of the young man is bringing forth a mere image and imposture or a real and genuine posture.
Good. Would you do the preceding paragraph, Socrates?
So great then is the importance of new ones.
Mm-hmm.
But their function is less important than mine. The women do not, like my patients, bring forth at one time real children and another time another mere images, which it is difficult to distinguish from the real. Or if they did, the greatest and noblest part of the work of midwives would be in distinguishing between the real and the false. Do you not think so?
Yeah, what's that? You read that? What conclusion do you come to then?
That, that is not midwife. Their function is less important than mine.
What's the highest and the noblest task of the midwives?
The highest and the noblest task of the human midwife?
Of the midwife is to do what?
Is to, would be. You mean would be?
Would you read the last paragraph, please?
So what I just read?
Yeah.
So great then is the importance of midwife, but their function is less important than mine. Women do not, like my patients, bring forth at one time real children and another time images, which is difficult to distinguish from the real. Where if they did, the greatest and noblest part of the work of midwives would be in distinguishing between the real and the false.
Mm-hmm.
Would be.
Mm-hmm.
Would be if they had that point. You know, if they had to have that.
Mm-hmm. Now, does he now talk about that very point?
Mm-hmm. It goes on down to there.
In the quote that we were just reading a moment ago. And the highest point of his art would be what? Discern the real from the unreal? Or? Right, so therefore, if this can be, if we can use the Theotetus as an example, this is an example then of the highest part of his art.
Well, that's right.
Is that right?
Of course.
Well then, if this is the highest point in his art, to prove by every test whether the offspring of the young man's thought is a phantom or something real, then how does this fit into it? What is he doing?
How is this analogous to...
Well, because
midwifery
doesn't have that
part. Right. Now that we got him with us, now we got him.
But the noblest part would be in distinguishing between the real and the false.
And how do you do that?
Well,
how do you do that, according to that text? What do you have to do?
test in every
by
way?
By testing in every way.
And how is this a test in every way?
Well, it seems like he's distinguishing between the real and the false, because these are false arguments. And he's bringing, he's making that distinction. That is a distinction.
Yeah, that is. Now, would you deal with the point? Yes, it is true that he could be making a distinction between real and false arguments. That's right. Okay. But that's not a test of a position, is it? Is this an exercise in teaching him how to reason? Mm. Or how to deliver him from something that's false? And to be able to test whether, in fact, it's false or not, or a phantom. You're using the same terms for arguments, aren't you? Right, the same. This is an example of a test of reality. So that you can test to see what's a sound and what is not a sound argument.
Right.
Jana, does it go beyond that in the section we just read? Saying, hey, look here.
Yeah.
If he had enough nerve, he would have held these positions.
Pythagoras said that, or would have said that.
Yeah. So he rebuilds the position, stronger than before. He overcomes the past objections.
I still don't see what he was doing. I mean, why did he even have to do that? Why not start out right there? You know, why go through all this showing a weaker position?
Yeah, but when did, yeah. Was the weakness of the position a function of Theaetetus?
Yes.
And then it's not weak. It just appeared that way.
Ah. Because he couldn't hold,
he couldn't
come back with, you know, he couldn't meet him argument for argument, or like two gladiators, one was weaker than the other. And that's not a fair fight. But Socrates would know that was probably the case.
I mean, he in fact says it. He says, you know, don't worry about it. You should be congratulated if you
want to race
against someone. Yeah.
Yeah. I still don't see what's there.
Well, let me put it in another way, right? Okay.
Maybe it makes you appreciate the rebuilding and the strength of the argument.
Yeah. Sometimes they call that a strawman argument.
Yeah.
He's not interested in the strawman argument. He's rebuilding and showing him exactly strength.
So if I was satisfied with that, that's all right. Cut it down pretty well.
Theaetetus' reaction to all of this is what? Right? Like 168C?
His head's spinning.
Such, Theodorus, is my contribution to the defense of your friend. The best I can make for my small means. Were he alive to speak for himself, it would be a much more impressive affair. Theodorus, you are not serious, Socrates. Your defense was most spirited. Let me put it, let me ask the same question that I asked last week this week. And let me go to a particular section. you remember the section that went from the Theaetetus says knowledge is nothing but
merely
nothing but.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's where
you agree then that Socrates rebuilds the position?
Mm-hmm.
And would you agree he also says that in his art he doesn't contribute anything to it, does he?
Mm-hmm.
Right. He said that again tonight.
Yeah, there's no wisdom in him, a wise invention of his own.
Yeah.
And there, that's why I always get someone to.
I want to go to 161b. Don't you see what is happening? The arguments never come out of me. They always come from the person I'm talking with. I am only at a slight advantage in having the skill to get some account of the matter from another's wisdom and entertain it with fair treatment. So now I shall not give any explanation myself, but try to get it out of our friend. The arguments never come out of me. They always come to the person I'm talking with. Mm-hmm. Would you agree that that was quite a build-up of his position? That knowledge is perception? He was willing just to say it's nothing but, it's merely perception. Did we not see last week how the man built it up for him? So sure then, all right? You not agree? He is building up the position, knowledge is perception. Far beyond what Theaetetus thought was contained in it. And now what's he doing? He's building up Protagoras' position.
Mm-hmm.
And we suspect far beyond his own statement of it. Okay.
So there's no anything
one,
left of it. You know?
161.
When it falls.
The arguments never come out of me. They always come out of the person I'm talking about. I'm only at a slight advantage having a skill to get some account of the matter from another person and entertain it with their treatment. Look here. Would you not agree? We might say that Theaetetus' position was like this.
He made a mountain
right.
Out of a molehill.
Socrates really built it, didn't he? Look here. In refuting it, what did he do?
Built it high.
He only took this part.
Right.
Knowledge is perception. He only took that part, didn't he? He didn't deal with the rest of it.
Man is immeasurable.
And he took it literally, didn't he? And started taking pot shots out of it, didn't he?
How easy it would be to do away with the
Chinese laundry.
Yeah. So then, look here. Then he rebuilds it. He rebuilds it again, right? Into this. So, look here. Didn't we think last time that Theaetetus, experiencing this, would he not have some sense that by heaven Socrates really took my position and made it immensely strong and gave it a depth?
Mm-hmm.
Didn't we say that?
Mm-hmm.
Didn't we? Mm-hmm. Look here. He's expanding it. He's giving it breath, is he not?
Mm-hmm.
Well, how about here? The same thing is going on here, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
The very same thing he's doing in both cases. The arguments never come out of me. They always come from the person I'm talking to. I'm only a slight advantage of being able to have the skill to get it out from the other. Is he saying, therefore, that Theaetetus had all of this within him?
Yep, he has to have it.
Huh?
All those implications have to be there.
No, are you saying the person he's talking to?
Breathing was in
the
tooth. All right, or is Socrates' skill, now watch now, all right, for a moment. Is Socrates' skill in midwifery that the difference between these two, one, two, three, four, that the difference between 1 and 3 is Socrates, right? This is where Theaetetus rests, doesn't he? This is what he thinks, 1 and 3. This is little position and this little position. And Socrates expands it, doesn't he? Then from 1 and 3 to 2 to 4 is a measure of the skill that Socrates is using in extracting all of that from him.
Right.
Is Socrates, all right, let's make Socrates over here. Okay. Is Socrates' skill in being able to do that, to pull that from him so that he then can see this from 1 to 2 and from 3 to 4?
Makes it conscious. Huh? Brings it to his consciousness.
Bring it to his consciousness.
And those are all the implications from that little seed.
Yeah. So if you're going to do supra-personal midwifery, what do you have to do?
You have to build that.
And by the way, can you not also, see, now we have this problem. Can we not also, or must we not also, show the weakness in understanding it on this level? Because it can be attacked on a superficial level. And yet it can be defended. What's that doing to our friend Theaetetus? Is he getting an education?
Well, I guess.
Okay, now some of you think that there may be a part of this that is rhetoric, which it very well is likely to be, since it's by Pythagoras, or presumed to be by Pythagoras. What does Socrates do with the rhetoric that may be, in fact, blowing this position up? What's he doing? What's he doing? How does he handle it?
Seems to me very noble. Very strong position.
You know what he does with it? He ignores it. He always ignores it. Right? He'll deal with the better part of what he just created.
Mm. That's the strongest part.
He'll take the strongest part of it. And he'll let the others drop by the wayside, even though he could make a great deal of fun of it, or analysis of it. So, let me ask you another way. How is Theaetetus, Theaetetus' idea being tested?
In every possible way.
And one of the ways is to build Theaetetus up. Mm-hmm. To make him the equal of the position. That's the test of a supra-personal problem. If a person can't do that, then they're not really in the position. They really are just talking out of some book learning. They don't really have it. They don't really live there. You see, how is Theaetetus' idea being tested? Well, we could specify in many ways. One way is Socrates is building Theaetetus's understanding of that position. Right. Hey, you You want to deal with it on a more sophisticated level? What are we going to have to do with you?
Right.
We're going to have to raise you up.
Right.
Right. We're going to have to push you up. We're going to have to. You're going to have to match the position. That's another test, isn't it? Build the person up. You find a weakness in the position, for God's sake, don't attack the person. Build them up. Build the position up. Build the person up. Show them, right? Point out to them the errors in their thinking. They don't have to have those errors. What's that doing to them?
Keeping them small. Restricting them.
Because
they're not realizing the truth.
Because? Keep going.
What's in the law? What's in the law?
Well, it's certainly, it's holding him to this position, isn't it? Like he won't let go. In that sense, he's restricting him, isn't he? And they're not going after the truth in this respect, are they? He's keeping him at this position, even when he builds it. He's going to keep him there, and he's trying to test the position and test him. And it's purgative. It's purgative, isn't it? Purgative. It's cleansing. It's purifying. It's getting rid of it.
Sure. It's making them look at it in different ways.
Good. What time is it? 9:25?
9:40.
What? 9:45.
9:45.
9:40.
Working
overtime.
Time and a half.
Without coffee.
The kind of started. No incentive.
So that the test is super personal.
See.
Super personal.
Thought they'd have at least a
week. What's the way you're going
to handle it? Well, yeah, well, to test the person to see whether or not.
Not truly pregnant. Kindled from a blessed tree, an olive, neither of the east nor of the west, whose oil would almost glow forth of itself, though no fire touched it. Light upon light. Allah guideth unto his light whom he will, and Allah speaketh to mankind in allegory, for Allah is knowable of all things. And it's called a similitude. I'm not sure if that's the right word or not.
The similitude of his light is as a niche wherein is a lamp. Okay, so there's a niche in the wall where there's a lamp. And the lamp is in a glass. And a glass is, as it were, a shining star.
So we've got levels of reality that we're talking about.
You have a wall.
that in the Middle East they had a glass lamp with olive oil,
mm-hmm.
and it cast light throughout the room.
Right.
The more brilliantly, the room would be lit.
I'm holding on. Wait, you got another image. So clean off a little part of there.
What?
The numbers alongside of it, to the right of it.
Here?
Yeah, clean it. So.
Mm-hmm.
Now, can you put some kind of an indicator that the lamp is kindled from a blessed tree? Okay, so like a stick or something.
Lamp is kindled.
The lamp is kindled from a blessed tree.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So it has to come over there some way. Yeah. Like well, it says olive. Oil.
Yeah.
Olive tree.
Yeah, that's true.
So what's the next kindling it is the olive oil. So it's the olives. Huh?
Well, the lamp is kindled from a blessed tree.
What is the source of what is burning?
Well, before we interpret
okay.
The lamp is kindled from a blessed tree, an olive, neither of these nor of the west.
Well, yours, so you're going strictly from the kindled as
yeah.
barking?
Yeah.
Oh, so you have to have like a kindling.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have to draw in here. Kindling.
The lamp is kindled from a blessed tree,
mm-hmm.
an olive. Neither of the east nor of the west. Whose oil, see the
mm-hmm.
tree's oil,
mm-hmm.
would almost glow
mm-hmm.
of itself.
Mm-hmm. Almost.
Almost, see? So it can't kindle it. The oil can't kindle it.
No.
Mm-hmm. Right?
Right.
The oil can't kindle it. Whose oil would almost glow forth of itself, though no fire touched it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Light upon light, Allah guideth unto his light whom he will.
I think we got one part of an analogy without the other part.
Well, first, let's make sure you have everything labeled, right?
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, what's the first part? As you see it, then?
There's a niche?
Okay, no. Allah is the light
mm-hmm.
of the heavens and the earth.
Yeah.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
His light is as a niche.
Is as a niche.
All right. So that's the analogy.
Mm-hmm. This whole niche.
Allah is the light of the heavens and the earth.
Mm-hmm.
The similitude of his light is blah, 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 blah.
Mm-hmm.
So you have, why don't you write it all the way up on top? Allah is light.
Mm-hmm.
Of H and E. All right. The similitude of his light is this mm-hmm. image.
As this niche is the light for the room.
Mm-hmm. And the lamp is in the glass.
Mm-hmm.
The glass is, as it were, a shining star. Do you have that there? Shining star.
put some points on it.
Chinese talk. Very green. Okay. Now it's kindled from a blessed tree.
Mm-hmm. That would be this, if I call it that, what we were discussing. Yeah.
An olive, neither the east nor the west, is oil will almost break forever. So.
Neither of the east nor the west. This is a curious phrase. I've heard one interpretation. The glass is as a shining star.
Yeah.
Right. So the glass, whatever it is the glass.
Mm-hmm.
Shines the light off.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, they say with a glass or lamp, it magnifies the light.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This kind of tree produces the purest olive oil.
Almost enough. Therefore, it needs something else to kindle.
Yeah, of itself it's not. But it's almost by itself luminescent. So when you bring kindling to it,
it just flares up.
It's light upon light.
Right.
Right. Right. And especially adding the effect of a glass to the more.
Right.
You're tied to Plato.
How so?
Thank you. Do you have anything anywhere else?
If, well, these people have something to say.
You sure bringing in an analogy, isn't it?
Who is it, the Koran?
Yeah, this is called the Verse of Light. And they want me to give a talk on the radio in July, so I'm planning now. I'm going to do it on the first of May. I'm doing a little homework on how to understand the analogy. Can you give me all the terms that are used in the Quran that in any way describe Muhammad?
I could find those, yeah.
What do we need to do? What could we do? Wouldn't it be nice if we would see a piece of glass?
Oh, yeah. So I'll find as Mohammed is to people, so the glass is to the lamp and the niche and the light in the darkness. Yeah. That would be good.
Yeah, go to one.
Because that would plug it in. It would make it an analogy and not just a simile.
Right.
Without that, it's just a simile. And that's why you can write so many interpretations of it.
Well, see, the key word is as.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because the Christians
say the same about Jesus, wouldn't they?
He's not as the light.
He is.
He is
the light, right? Yeah. He's not as.
John.
Right? So that there's a classic difference between the two systems.
Mm-hmm.
But that is analogous.
Yeah.
Take an analogy or simile and read it literally.
Now, it's real interesting to know that you really have to have a good translation.
Yeah.
Because kindling.
The word for kindling.
And oil.
Mm-hmm.
They're almost the same thing, aren't they? Fuel. And you're going to have to see some very fine distinctions.
Mm-hmm. The source.
Trees,
let's see if we can do it.
Huh? Mm-hmm. Nice. I don't know.
The source of the fire, source of the light, is the kindled oil in the lamp. Right?
Wow.
The kindling is from the olive tree. That's kindling from the olive tree.
Mm-hmm.
Then the kindling is precise. Right, then it's kindling from an olive tree.
Mm-hmm.
So you have the kindling and you have a statement of the oil itself is nearly luminescence. You nearly don't need the kindling.
Mm-hmm. Hmm? Codependent origination.
Yeah. Sure as hell looks that way, doesn't it? Right? You could pull that into that, couldn't you?
Yeah. I was wondering about like emanation. because this isn't a primary metaphor or emanation, a rays coming off from a light source.
Well, clearly, right? Let's do that, right? The source of the light is the kindle oil and oil. The light itself is all.
Mm-hmm.
What? This is a kindled light. Right? This is a kindled light. That's not that light.
No. That's not good.
Right. This is in a house, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, I would sure like to see the role of the word olive, kindling, in the
Quran.
Olive, olive tree, olive oil, one,
mm-hmm.
Two, three. Now, if this is in a house, right, if this is a niche in someone's house, then that's for the family, that's for the individual. That's for
the light that makes it possible to do anything in the house.
Mm-hmm.
Everything that was done in the house by that light, mm-hmm. The family.
No. Muhammad is the kindling. The truth is nearly pre-existent. Truth is always there. It's nearly luminous in itself. He's the kindling.
Mm-hmm.
He's the kindling of the truth.
Is the Koran then the light or something?
Yeah.
Light coming.
Right. So the lamp is the Koran.
Mm-hmm.
Right, that
yes.
Heightens it or discharges it. He was the kindler. The oil is the truth.
Prophet is to kindle the truth.
Yeah, kindle the truth. Oh, no, kindle the truth. Kindle the truth, that's right.
So that it makes illumination on a given decision.
Well, it's for mankind. It's for whatever is the lamp does in the niche.
Yeah. Whoever benefits from the light.
Mm-hmm. But see, they're going back to that image,
mm-hmm.
of the lamp and the niche and saying, that's a star.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's heaven light. That's
like a star.
Like a star. That's pretty powerful stuff.
This is the one that the Sufis like this by a lot. This is the one that Al-Ghazali usually writes against emanation, against new frequency, but in his commentary on this passage, he can't help himself. Starts talking about emanation.
Right.
Who does this?
Alcatel.
Alcatel. You know something?
After.
How did you do it, Jim?
He mentions the first emanation from the ultimate. No, I don't recall.
Or Brennan.
It looks like this is plugging this. Looking into Plato, it seems to make all of the ideas good.
Yeah, it's all the ideas good.
So that there's something higher than Allah if you stay strictly with Plato.
Better hide that one for a while.
But that certainly is a nice difference between Christianity.
Yeah. John 1. Jesus is the light of the world.
The glass is as a shining star, so that really ignites. Mm-hmm. That's the color, aren't you? Mm-hmm. How many more sections do they have on the light?
On light?
That's, all of us assemble. And the olive by Mount Sinai.
and by this land made safe, surely we created man of the best stature.
So it has that. For those three.
All of it.
Yeah. Something to swear by, associated with Sinai, and the fig tree.
So the essence of Mount Sinai is the oil. All of the essence.
Mm-hmm.
So here's the Kindlewood.
Mm-hmm. And therefore, he brings something which is like putting a niche with lamps in your house so that you can see and be guided, find your way. Don't some of the... Isn't there a whole Buddhist section called the transmission of the land?
Yeah.
So it's popular.
But I see what's missing in the story is where is the kindler to be kindled?
That's Dr. Jim's problem.
Yeah. Where do you get the light? Where do you get the light to kindle
it? You kindle the kindling. With a kindling. Light in the kindling.
You got to start it burning, right?
Mm-hmm.
You got to start it burning somewhat.
Yeah.
And that's your participation for it. The Muhammad is the kindling.
Yeah.
But he had to pass the light of Allah into the niche, into the land.
Mm-hmm.
And that's participation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he had to go get it, didn't he? Yeah, that's kind of a go.
It was brought to him by angel. Gabriel.
Yeah, but you have to go to the tree,
right?
You have to go to the tree and bring it from the tree to kindle the light.
Right, it has to be brought from the tree to kindle the light.
So to go to the light, you got to participate in that tree.
You're part of it. You're the kindling.
And yes, you're participating in it when you bring it back.
Okay.
He sees himself as a branch. The tree of Abraham.
Well, yeah. Well, Abraham and Mount Sinai are linked.
Yeah.
Now we split off with Ishmael from Isaac and Jacob.
Somebody made any mention of Carter's book. They're not reading that.
Whose book?
Carter's book.
Yeah.
The Blood of Abraham. Nobody seems to pay any attention to it. I don't see people walking around with it under their eyes.
I don't think they want to read anything other than a book on the Bible.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a problem.
Well,
this was good. This gave me
Let's know what you think of it.
Yeah. We're having fun.